Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Samuel Sutanto, and thank you for inviting me to present my works here. Today, I will give a presentation about reducing the impacts of compound and cascading dry hazards, namely drought, heatwave, and fire. I would like also to acknowledge my main collaborators, Claudia Vitolo, Claudia Di Napoli, Henny van Lanen, and Frederik Wetterhall. This slide shows the impact of natural hazards to human from year 2008 to 2017. If we look at the number of affected people, then drought is the number one hazard that affects around 73.9 million people, followed by floods, 73.1 million, and after that storm, 33.9 million people. Heatwave and fire only count for 9 and 0.1 million people respectively. The highest impact is found in the least developed country. In terms of economic losses, more than 100 billion euro lost due to drought in the past 30 years in Europe. Please remember, this number is not including the drought in 2018. In the US, around 2.2 billion US dollar lost during the 2014 California drought. And just for agriculture drought in the Netherlands, around 820 million up to 1.4 billion euro lost during drought events in 2018-2019. This figure below, taken from the Food Agriculture Organization, shows the top 10 disasters causing greatest damage to agriculture. And drought contribute to 10.5 billion US dollar. The impact from natural hazards singly will be higher if there is an occurrence of compound and a cascading hazard. An example can be seen in this figure. This figure shows the drought index derived from the precipitation data, namely standardized precipitation index. If we look at this figure, we can notice that droughts in 1976 and drought in 1996 had higher severity than drought in 2003. However, combined with heat waves and fires, the hazard event in 2003 was one of the most fatal and costly, with more than 70,000 people passed away and economic loss accounted for more than 8.7 billion euro. Despite the high impacts from compound and cascading hazards, most of studies that have been carried out treat dry hazards as a single hazard. In fact, all these three dry hazards, drought, heatwave, and fire, are interrelated. For example, drought triggers and increases the probability of heatwave, and vice versa, heatwave triggers and increases the probability of drought. On the other hand, drought only increases the probability of fire, and fire does not trigger and increase the probability of drought, at least for short term. Meanwhile, heat wave increases the probability of fire, and fire triggers and increases the probability of heat wave. Because of this, we need to always consider the occurrences of compound and cascading events and not only single hazard alone. And most studies only deal with a single hazard due to the challenges of analyzing a multi-hazard framework. The figures below show the number of compound and cascading dry hazard occurrences and the durations of compound and cascading dry hazard from 1990 to 2018 based on the reanalysis data. The drought was identified using soil moisture data, the heat wave was identified using temperature data, and fire was identified based on the fire weather index approach. If we look at only the number of compound and cascading dry hazard event, then West, Central, and East Europe are regions that prone to compound and cascading dry hazards. However, in terms of duration, certain European countries such as Portugal, Spain, Italy, and Greece are prone to long compound and cascading dry hazard events. The next figure here summarizes the percentage of area in Europe that was affected by single and compound hazards. Drought is the hazard that affects most of the European countries, followed by fires, compound drought and fires, and heat waves. One should note that all the data here were generated from the reanalysis products and not based on the real observed event. Up to this slide, I discussed with you the impacts of dry hazards and the importance of considering the compound and cascading events. Then, what can be done to reduce the impact of the compound and cascading hazards, since the occurrences of dry hazards will be higher in the future due to climate change? There are many ways to reduce the impacts of natural hazards. And starting from this slide onward, I will discuss with you some examples that have been done in our project to reduce the impacts of dry hazards by promoting early detection of hazard and possible impact occurrences through early warning system forecasting and providing climate services to end user. And this is in line with one of the 10-day disaster risk reduction global targets, which is availability and access to multi-hazard early warning systems and disaster risk information and assessment. And this slide shows the Anywhere Multi-Hazard Early Warning System platform. The Anywhere Multi-Hazard Early Warning System provides information on the occurrences of many weather-related hazards from 1 to 7 days ahead for flood, storm, wind, and heatwave, for example, and up to 7 months ahead for drought. However, the Anywhere Multi-Hazard Early Warning System does not show the occurrences of compound and a cascading event. This can be done just by overlapping the hazard maps in the Anywhere Early Warning System. And here the figure on the left shows an example of the forecasted heat and fire as single hazard and as the compound hazard using ECMWF 10 days forecast issued on 17 June 2017. And from this figure, we can notice that fire, heatwave, and compound fire and heatwave were forecasted to occur in Portugal, Spain, and to some extent in France and Italy. But if we look into more detail in Portugal that was hit by severe fire and heatwave in June 2017, the compound of heatwave and fire that struck Portugal can be predicted using forecasts initiated on 7 June 2017, or 10 days ahead. If we look at the right figure over here and the red line, we see that with using the forecast initiated in the 7 June 2017, basically we can predict that more than 50% the area in Portugal will be hit by the compound drought, fires and a heat wave. And this study, however, is still an experimental phase, and some works need to be done to implement this method to operational early warning system. Next is another example on how the impacts of drought can be forecasted using the random forest approach by linking seasonal drought forecasts with drought impact database. This example shows forecasted drought impact on water quality, freshwater ecosystem, and terrestrial ecosystem in Brandenburg, Germany. All the blue lines in this figure show the forecasted likelihood of impact occurrence using reforecast data initiated every month for 7 months ahead from year 2002 to 2012. Now let's look in detail drought event in year 2003, shown by this rectangular red color over here, and drought in 2006. The right figure show how the drought impact model can forecast the drought impact in year 2003 and 2006. For 2003 drought, the top figures, the impacts can be predicted 2 months in advance. This is shown by the blue and purple color. While for 2006 drought, the impact can be predicted even up to 6 months in advance. This is shown by the yellow color over here. Again, this work is still in an experimental phase. Some works needs to be done to implement this method to operational early warning system and to forecast the impacts caused by the compound event. This slide shows the water apps that has been developed for farmers in Ghana and Bangladesh. Using this interactive app, the farmer can input the forecast data based on the indigenous local knowledge. For example, the occurrences of some animals, here for example like an insect, bird, and also the occurrence of weather phenomena related to extreme weather events. For example, like a strong wind from a certain region if there is a red circle around the sun. And the farmers can also get information from the scientific forecast for 1, 7, and 14 days ahead. And later, we extend it to seasonal forecast for better agriculture planning. This slide shows that we also train the farmers on how to interpret and use the mobile apps by creating forum group discussions. The aims of the FGD are, first, to build the farmers' capacity toward weather, water, and climate events that will increase the community resilience. And the second, build the farmers' capacity towards information and communication technology and the use of mobile app. And third, co-develop water, climate, agricultural advisory services. Based on the information from the app, the farmers can adapt their planning and possible extreme weather events that may occur in the coming weeks and months. From this slide onwards, I will show you how the forecasted reservoir volume can help to reduce the impact of dry hazards in Catalonia and some examples of the adaptation strategies applied during drought events. The red, orange, and yellow areas indicate the reservoir volume in the emergency, exceptional, and alert situation, respectively. The last reservoir volume was observed in May 2017. And the forecast shows that reservoir volume will decrease in the coming month. This is shown by the dashed lines. Lately, in November 2017, indeed the reservoir volume was near to the alert situation, close to the minimum forecasted volume. And then, what adaptation strategies can be performed when we are at the alert situations? During normal conditions, the water in the reservoir can be used up to 60%. During arid conditions, the water in the reservoir can be used up to 40% and the rest are from groundwater, desalinization, and reuse water. During emergency, only 20% water in the reservoir can be used. The right figures show the municipality supplies in average for citizens and industry in Barcelona. During arid, maximum 250 liters per day is provided. But during the emergency situations, only 200 liters per day water are provided and it decreases to 160 liters per day when they have emergency phase 3. These are other examples of adaptation strategies that are planned to cope with drought situation in Catalonia. During arid situations, irrigation can be carried out only in the evening to reduce the losses of water due to evapotranspiration with maximum 450 meter cubic water per hectare per month. For private watering, for example for your garden, it is allowed only 2 days a week. Giving water to plants are prohibited during the emergency situations. And during these emergency situations, cleaning streets, pavements, and facades for private purposes is prohibited. This can only be done if there is a health or road safety risk or an accident. For cleaning vehicle, it is allowed only for commercial vehicles such as food transport and ambulance. For a private car, cleaning is allowed only to clean the glasses, light, and mirror. These all are applied for all conditions from arid to emergency. To end my presentation, there are 5 messages that can be derived from my talks. First, we need to focus more to the occurrence of compound and cascading hazards instead of only single hazard, since compound and cascading hazard trigger higher impacts. Second, multi-hazard early warning system, including research to predict compound and cascading events, exists, but some work needs to be done to implement this in the operational mode. Third, hazard impact, remember not indices, can be predicted well in advance, but no study predicts the impact of compound and cascading hazards yet due to the missing knowledge in predicting the impact of compound and cascading hazards. Fourth, water app and forum group discussion have been implemented in Ghana and Bangladesh, and this can also be implemented in other regions. And this activity helps the farmer to increase the awareness and adaptation strategies on the upcoming extreme weather events. Last, with advanced information on the occurrences of dry hazards, including their possible compound nature, some adaptation strategies can be well planned. And with this slide, I would like to say thank you for your invitation and for your attention. And a detail of this talk you can see from the study stated below.